Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in tonight. Hungry for God Church, we are back for another powerful virtual Bible study. I want to welcome everyone that is tuning in for the first time. I am Pastor Vernel Samuel, senior leader here at Hungry for God Church, and welcome. We're getting ready to jump into tonight's teaching, and so everyone that is joining us tonight, whether this is your first time, second time, or you've been with us, I just want you to come in, get your Bible, get a notepad, or if you're driving, just listen up. If you're watching the replay, you can always come in and just type in the chat. We want some interactions here because right now we are live, and so those of you that are watching, just let us know where you're watching from, and so just type in the chat. What city, what town, what nation, what country you are watching from. Okay, I'm looking forward to seeing some of those comments. So let me know where you're watching from. Let us know where you're watching from. Amen. Yes, yes. And at the same time, we are going to open up in a word of prayer as we're getting ready to come into tonight's teaching on authority in Christ. Authority in Christ. And we've been in a couple of weeks we're in so far. Speaking about authority, last week we talked about taking authority over Satan's kingdom. And that was a powerful, powerful, powerful teaching. And I'm pumped. I'm excited to share this word with you. Even as the song we were just listening to, one word from God, everything has to come under his command. Because the God we serve, whose name is Jesus, has been given all authority in heaven and on earth. And the Bible says that he's given us that authority. Tonight, I want to speak to you a little bit more about how to grow in authority, how to level up in your authority. Like, how many of you want to move in greater authority? Let me see a show of hands. Right? If you want to grow in new levels of authority, you want to listen up to this teaching, all right? Because I'm going to teach you the process of how to grow in authority. And so if you're ready to begin, let me see you type in the chat, let's go. Let's go. If you're ready to jump into tonight's teaching, yep, some of you already said I've been ready. Just say I'm ready. Let's go. Type in let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Yeah, let's go. All right. So as always, I also want you to do a few more things. Push the like button. Let's let YouTube know that there are people on here that are watching that are excited about the teaching and the preaching of the Word of God. So push the like button. That'll help us get the algorithms in our favor. All right, if you also want to share this with some friends who you also believe will benefit from tonight's teaching. But I believe that this teaching on authority is one of the most critical and crucial lessons that you can learn today, because God needs his people to start stepping up and taking authority over things that's happening in this world. You know, there's a lot of things happening in the world that people are blaming God for that is not even God's fault. It's the church's fault. I just put it out there. It's our fault. When darkness and evil seems to be ruling and reigning the world, it's because the church is not ruling and reigning in those places. You know, there are so many things, there are so many areas, industries that have been under the control of satanic agendas and influencers and influencers, simply because there are not more believers rising up and shining in the darkness. The Bible says that darkness or evil is overcome by good. So when those who know good and are good are not walking in the light of that goodness, if they're just sitting back and putting their heads in the sand and letting things go on around them in their community, there's areas in our community that young men are in need of fathers, discipleship. But where are the righteous? You know, I love this story of Sodom and Gomorrah for the purpose that, or for the reason that many people don't. Everyone judges Sodom and Gomorrah because of the sin of homosexuality that we see in that town. But what if I told you God destroying Sodom and Gomorrah was not even about the sin of homosexuality? Okay? The reason why God judged that town was not just because of the sin. It was because there was a lack of righteous men and women in that town who were supposed to be the salt of Sodom and Gomorrah. See, when God told Abraham that he was getting ready to destroy the town, he came to Abraham, and Abraham was interceding on behalf of that town. And God said to him, Abraham, show me 100 righteous. And he went down the list from 100 down to just simply one. And God said, show me one righteous. If the righteous are standing tall in that area, I will not destroy that town. Go back and read it. And because the righteous were not standing, were not ruling, the Bible says, when the righteous rule, the people rejoice. So the righteous were not ruling in Sodom and Gomorrah, which meant that people were free to do whatever they want, whatever iniquity, whatever sin they were living in. It was because of the lack of a righteous leadership or people who were supposed to be in authority not ruling well. And so when God got ready to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, he first started, he said, show me those who were supposed to be in authority, who were righteous, who were not present. So this issue of authority is so important. Okay, and so let me start in prayer because I'm already teaching. I'm already jumping in, but y'all already said y'all ready. So just put your hand on your heart because this is the place where you receive revelation from. Put your hand on your heart, and I want you to just pray with me. Say, Lord, teach me your ways. Open the eyes of my heart. Allow me to see what you want me to see. If there's any areas in my life that need to change, let it be changed. Let there be light in any area where there's darkness. I'm ready to grow. I'm ready to mature. I'm ready to be all that you created me to be. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for teaching me on how to abide in Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we are speaking about authority. Let's turn our Bibles. Let's look at Mark chapter 1, okay? Let's look at Mark chapter 1, and we're going to look at verse 21. Mark 1, verse 21. And the Bible says, and they went into Capernaum, and straightaway on the Sabbath day, he entered into the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority. Talking about Jesus, he taught them as one that had authority and not as the scribes. Okay, so it's amazing how the people recognized that Jesus was different by his teaching style, that Jesus had a teaching style that was authoritative. In comparison to the scribes and the religious leaders of his day, they didn't teach the same way that Jesus taught. And so they said, the Bible says he taught as one that had authority. So just to help you getting a cultural and historical background really, really quickly, the way that the Jewish rabbis taught in the synagogues, they oftentimes had debates. You remember when Jesus was 12 years old and he went into the synagogue, and when his parents were looking for him, they found him in the synagogue debating with the doctors and the lawyers and the religious leaders? Right? Because the way they taught in synagogues, they did not teach authoritative. But they oftentimes talk with speculations, questions, and they would debate on topics. So for example, if we're talking about, let's say, the topic of demons, they would talk about, well, a lot of theory. They talked about a lot of theory, a lot of myths, or a lot of facts, but nothing, you didn't leave walking away like you knew the truth. Because no one really taught truth. They just taught facts. Are you understanding what I'm saying? They just gave you information and debated on it because one person had a theory about demons and say, well, they believe that some demons were like this. Another person would have a theory and say, well, demons were Greek gods. Somebody else would say something like they came from Africa. Who knows? And you didn't walk away really having a solid conviction that something was true. Ha! But they couldn't give you the truth because they didn't have the truth. Because the truth is not information. The truth is a person. See, Jesus said, I am the way. I am the truth. And I am the life. So truth is not information, church. Truth is a person. So when truth manifested in human form right in front of their eyes, when he spoke, there was no debate. There was no going back and forth or speculation about what he said because the truth is talking. Hallelujah. And so when they heard truth speaking to them, when truth began to speak, they said, this man is speaking with authority. He's not speaking like the rest of the scribes and the religious leaders. He knows what he's talking about. Or at least it sounds like he knows exactly what he's talking about because he did know exactly what he was talking about. He created all things. He knew all things. This Bible, this scriptures that you're reading is about me. All right? So he taught them as one that had authority, not like the scribes. Verse 23. And there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, saying, leave us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee, who thou art, the Holy One of God. So now here it is. There was a man who was in the synagogue who had an evil spirit, or the Bible says an unclean spirit inside of him. The Bible literally says that as Jesus was teaching with authority, it caused an unclean spirit that was hiding in a man to manifest. There's something about anointed teaching, authoritative teaching, that causes demons to flee. That exposes demonic spirits. Okay? So when the scribes and the rabbis were doing all their debating, that man never got free. But when Jesus showed up, speaking with authority, teaching with authority, that demon could not stand sitting there any longer, hiding in that man. Hallelujah. I pray that my teaching will be under such heavy anointing and backed by spiritual authority to the point where any unclean spirits that's lingering and listening to me cannot stay where you are by virtue of the authority of the presence of God. Amen? So anyway, this man who was hiding, the demon, I should say, that was hiding in this man, immediately revealed himself, began to say, Jesus, have you come to destroy us? Now watch this. The Bible says in verse 25, and Jesus rebuked him, saying, hold your peace and come out of him. And when the unclean spirit had torn him, it cried out with a loud voice, and he came out of him. Verse 27, and they were all amazed insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, what thing is this? And what new doctrine is this? For with authority commandeth he the unclean spirits, and they do obey him. All right? So once again, we see, as I explained, how Jesus had a unique or different teaching style in comparison to the scribes, because he taught as one with authority. Last week, I shared how authority is not having a mic. Some people feel like if they have a mic in church, they got authority. Authority is not a mic. Authority is not yelling. Authority is not screaming, shouting, stomping your feet at the devil. That's not authority. That's noise. Okay? True authority does not have to yell. Authority is not the volume. It's not the loudness. It's not yelling or screaming. Authority is not even a title. Some people have titles to represent authority, but giving yourself a title or calling yourself something does not mean you have authority in the realm of the spirit. Spiritual authority, like we learned last week, authority simply means the right to act. Authority is a revelation of who you are in Christ. And because of who you are in Christ, you have authority. So we spent a lot of weeks talking about this, and we see here Jesus himself, he operated from a place of authority. Authority. Understanding he had a right to act. Understanding that he had a revelation of who he was. I am the Son of God. And it's amazing. I want you to pay attention to this. Even the unclean spirits understand authority. Unclean spirits understand authority. I want you to write that down in the chat, or write this down. Demons understand authority. Demons understand authority. Unclean spirits understand authority. Notice that when the Son of God, or Jesus, gave them a command, the Bible says they had to obey him. The people said, "For with authority commandeth he the unclean spirits," and they obey him. They obey him. Unclean spirits obey Jesus, obey the Christ, obey the Son of God. They understand the authority that's in Christ. Why does Christ have authority? Because he's the Son of God. Because the highest authority in the universe is Almighty God and his word. There is no authority higher than God and his word. I want you to also write that down. There is no authority higher than God and his word. That's why we see in John 1, the Bible says, "In the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God." And we see that God and his word are one. One, the same, equal. That's very important to understand. Authority, the highest authority in the universe, in both heaven and earth, in the third heavens and in the lowest of hell, all in between, all principalities, powers, visible, invisible, ranks, protocol, positions, doesn't matter. There is no authority higher than God and his word. So the unclean spirits who are in Satan's kingdom understand rank and authority. So when someone who had greater authority than them, who was Jesus, the Son of God, the Word made flesh, when he opened up his mouth and gave a command, that unclean spirit in that man had to go. And not only do we see it in that man, we see it throughout the entire duration of Jesus' ministry, that every time he spoke to an unclean spirit, no unclean spirit, no demon in hell could defy, rebel, oppose, withstand, resist the authoritative instruction of Jesus. When Jesus spoke, they had to listen. They had to come out of a person. Once Jesus said go, they had to go. All they had to ask was, Jesus, can you send us somewhere else? Can you send us in those pigs? But the authority that Jesus carried, I want you to also understand this. Hear me. Jesus said, all authority has been given to me. Matthew 28. Now go into all the world. And I showed you how the same authority that Jesus had, he gave to you and me today. Hallelujah. That those of us who have surrendered and submitted our lives to the Word of God and to Jesus the Christ, those of us that have made Jesus our Lord, we have now come under his authority. And when you come under someone else's authority, what's on their life begins to get on your life. When you surrender and submit to someone else's authority, what's on them can get on you. And this is why I taught you guys before that authority must be given, right? You cannot give yourself authority. Authority is transferred and given over to you. So once again, when I say, hey, how many of you want authority? And many of you said, hey, I want authority. I want to grow in authority. Like, I want to be able to command unclean spirits and tell them to go, and they go too. I want to take authority over Satan. You remember I told you guys also, what extent does our authority travel to? Do we have authority to over time, for example? Do we have authority over people? Do we have authority over, you know, nature? What do we have authority to do, the right to act on? Well, for basics, we must understand we don't have authority to rule and to dominate other human beings. We were not given authority to rule other human beings. We were given authority over Satan's kingdom. Luke 10, verse 19. Luke 10, verse 19. Jesus said, behold, I give you power or authority to trample over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm you. Okay? So Jesus has given us the authority over Satan's kingdom. Over Satan's kingdom. Say, I have authority over Satan's kingdom. Okay? You have the authority, the right to act, to trample on serpents and scorpions, to walk all over demonic powers, demonic agendas. The light is stronger than the darkness. Satan's kingdom is called the kingdom of darkness. Those of us that are in Christ are in the kingdom of light. Light is greater than darkness. Amen? Light is stronger than darkness. If the room is dark and you put the light on, the darkness can never overpower the light. It must leave when the light turns on. This is why this revelation and this truth is so important, because the more I teach you and the more you agree and believe and submit to the revelation of the authority that Christ has and the authority you have when you learn to submit fully under his rule and his reign and his instructions and his teachings and his principles and his precepts, the more you allow the Word of God to rule your life, you will find yourself walking in authority over every ruler of darkness, over every demonic spirit. Demons know who has authority and who doesn't. And the only way you are going to grow in authority, church, is by learning how to submit to God's authority. See, this is the secret to growing in new strength. This is the secret to growing in new power. Learning how to submit to authority. Let me look at another verse. The Bible tells us in, let's look at the book of James, right quick. James chapter 5. We're in the New Testament still. Hebrews, then James. Look at what James has to say. James. All right, James. I don't have my typical Bible. I'm sorry, James chapter 4. James 4. Verse 6. But he giveth, talking about God, he giveth more grace. Wherefore he says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace unto the humble. What is grace? Grace is divine favor. It's also God's divine enablement. God's divine enablement. God empowering you with his presence and his power to do what you could not do in your own strength. Okay? So God is giving you grace, ability, capacity, power. He gives grace to who? The humble, but he resists the proud. One of the characteristics or the qualities of humble people is that humble people know how to follow instructions. Humble people don't mind being told what to do. Humble people are teachable. Teachable. And the only way that you can grow in maturity is by learning how to become humble. You see, prideful people don't want to be told what to do. Prideful people want to answer to themselves. Prideful people believe that they themselves can correct themselves. No one can correct me. No one can share, give me any type of feedback. Prideful people walk around unsubmitted. See, humble people have learned to submit, learned how to be obedient to people above them. Prideful people don't want to submit to anyone. So the grace to increase and to grow in God's favor and God's power is not coming to you if you practice pride. It'll only come to you if you practice humility. Humility is a choice. That's why the Bible tells you to humble yourself, because you have the ability to decide if you're going to choose to live a humble life, humble, submitted life, or you're going to choose to live a prideful life. Rebellious people are prideful. They don't want to be told what to do. I'll get back to that in a little while. But look at what the Bible says, according to verse 7. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Remember what we said, God is the highest authority, and he and his word are one. So submitting yourselves, therefore, to God also means submitting yourself to the word. If I don't submit to God's word, I don't submit to God. I cannot live a life in disobedience to the word and think that I am living a life of submission to God. He and his word are one. He and his word are one. So how do you practically submit yourself to God? You submit to what his word says. Here we go. So this is where we begin to draw a line in the sand between self-proclaiming Christians, people who say they are Christians, and people who actually live the lifestyle, people who actually walk with God, people who actually are disciples. There's a lot of Christians, but not enough disciples. And Jesus called his followers disciples. As a disciple, you are a disciplined one. You are someone who has decided to submit yourself to the instructions and the disciplines and the teachings of a master. So when the disciples, you're talking about Peter, James, John, all these people who left their businesses and chose to follow Jesus and become his disciples, they submitted themselves to the curriculum, to the training, to the correction, to the development and the alignment of Jesus, taking heed to everything he had to tell them. That's a very humble decision or a humble process to decide to listen to someone else. I mean, think about Peter, for example, right? When Peter was fishing all night and he couldn't catch any fish. And the Bible says that Jesus then shows up at the seashore and tells a professional fisherman who makes his living fishing. Now, Jesus was a carpenter. He wasn't a fisher. In the natural, Jesus was a carpenter. So now here's this carpenter walking by. Peter is out toiling and struggling to catch fish all night. Then Jesus calls out to Peter and says, "Hey, Peter, throw your nets on the other side." Peter's pride could have said, and you know Peter had a potty mouth, right? You know Peter cussed out a little girl before he went to the cross. I mean, before Jesus went to the cross. So Peter could have said, "Who do you think you are to tell me how to fish? I've been fishing longer than you. I know more about fish. I've been in this sea for years." And he could have went on and on and on. But then Peter humbled himself, said, "Well, at your word, I'll let down the net." Jesus actually said to Peter, "Throw your nets on the other side." But Peter had a recognition that this man Jesus, who my brother Andrew told me about, there's something special about him. So here it is, Jesus says, "Throw your nets on the other side." Peter said, "At your word. I've been doing it all night, but because you said so, I'll do it." Guys, Peter reluctantly threw out a net and caught so much fish at one time that other fishermen had to come and help before the boat was going to tip over by how much fish, glory to God, was about to fill that boat. Woo, glory. I believe that there are some areas in your life right now, it seems void and it seems like you've been lacking. You seem like things are not working for you because you are still trying to do it in your own strength. But if you listen and take heed to the word of God and do what God says to do, one word from God will change your entire life. One word from God can change your finances. One word from God can pull you out of depression and discouragement. One word can change everything that's happening in your life. But you know what? You have to humble yourself to obey the word of God. Peter obeyed. He did what God said to do, even when he didn't feel like it. One word from God can change your marriage. There's something that God is telling you to do that you are ignoring him and still trying to do it your way. When you do it your way, it's harder because there's no grace on doing things your way. The grace of God comes when you do things God's way. And the choice to do things God's way is called humility. And humility begins with submission. 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 Submit yourselves, therefore, to God, because he gives grace to the humble. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I want my life to be easy. I don't want my life to be harder than it's supposed to be. Life is hard already. I'm not going to make my life harder If God gives grace to the submitted and to the humble, I'm going to submit myself to him. I want to do what his word says to do because I know he's going to put grace on it. Ooh, glory to God. Come on, God is about to put some grace on your marriage to make things easier at home. He's going to put his grace on his children. Or children, God's going to put some grace on you when you learn to do what he says to do. And God has a word that can deal with every single situation that you're going through in your life. So you submit to God. He will give you grace, his favor, his ease, his power, his ability, his capacity to do what he says you can do, and will allow you to prosper. Okay? Now, look at verse 7. As we keep reading, submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Woo! Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, this lets us know another thing. If you are unsubmitted to God, the devil will be irresistible to you. If you are not submitted to God, the devil will be irresistible to you. You know what that means? You cannot resist the devil. Unsubmitted people cannot resist the devil. Why? Because you don't have the strength. You don't have the grace. You don't have the capacity. Remember what I said earlier. Authority is relational. He gives his authority. Authority is God-given. So just like he gives his grace to the humble, authority is a grace from God. God gives you the grace to have authority in areas that and other people don't. Okay? But he only gives this grace to the humble. So if I'm going to learn how to increase in authority, I got to learn how to humble myself. And I learn to humble myself by learning how to get under someone else's authority. Did you see that? To get under someone else's authority. I learn how to submit to the word of God. And when you begin to get into the word, you will begin to find that God in his word begins to give us instructions as to how we are supposed to live our lives. And he also tells us who we are supposed to submit to. One of the most important decisions that you can ever make in life is the decision on deciding who to submit to. Because who you submit to can also determine what enters in your life and what exits your life. You submit to the wrong people, the wrong things are going to enter into your life. You submit to the right people, the right things begin to come into your life. But you cannot try to resist the devil if you are not living a submitted life to God. So the Bible says, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Amen? So, I gave you a number of takeaways so far about how to grow and how to walk in authority. Authority. You know, authority, we're supposed to learn how to submit to authority at home. So Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1 tells us, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, and you shall live, or you shall have a long life, okay? So you learn how to obey authority. The first place you're supposed to learn how to obey authority is at home, the leadership at home. Okay, all of us are supposed to practice learning how to obey the commands, the teachings, the instructions of people in authority on our lives. But unfortunately, today and many cases, due to bad parenting or people who just didn't know how to handle authority or responsibility, misusing it and abusing it, can cause people to feel anger and pain towards authority. And I want you to know that this was all the devil's doing. The devil will inspire people in authority to mistreat, abuse their authority, perverting the way people see leadership and see authority. You see, many people now have this lingering or prevailing attitude and spirit that I'm going to do whatever I want. No one is going to be able to tell me what to do. No one is going to tell me how to live my life. Nobody's going to tell me how to think. I'm going to do me. Basically, you're confessing out of your mouth that you're going to live a rebellious, hellish life. One of the most demonic things you can ever do in your life is live a life of rebellion. Because that's how this whole thing started. Satan and his kingdom, which are made of other fallen angels, they all came out of heaven through a rebellion that they went up against God. That they had the audacity to believe that they can actually try to resist God and not listen to God and not obey God. And God kicked all of these angels out of heaven. And rebellion was the result. What we see, the spirit of rebellion, notice rebellion and pride goes hand in hand, because Lucifer, the Bible says that pride was found in his heart. We find that in Isaiah 14, that pride was found in his heart. And he said, I will ascend into the mountain of God. I'm going to go into heaven and I will. He sought to rebel against God. Okay, so rebellion came as a result of pride, which means that the first sin in history was pride. Lucifer got into pride, and as a result of pride, he got into rebellion. So you see the connection between pride and rebellion, why God doesn't give his grace to the prideful, because the prideful will always rebel against God. Prideful people will always rebel against leadership. And when you enter into rebellion, you breach the code of honor that sustains the kingdom of God. But you should also know this. Rebellion never works. I want you to write that down in the chat. How much time I got? Rebellion never works. Rebellion never works. It didn't work in heaven when Lucifer tried it. It's not going to work on earth. Every time there was some type of rebellion, even in the natural, it never works. Rebellions always fail. Why? Because it's only a matter of time. When you sow the seed of rebellion, you are going to reap a harvest of rebellion. If you rebel against your parents, disobey them, dishonor them, you know what you're doing? You're sowing a seed of rebellion and dishonor. So when you have your kids, don't sit there complaining and wondering why they don't listen to you. They don't listen to you because you don't listen to your parents, or you rebelled against your parents. And a lot of us don't like this, but whatever you sow is what you're going to reap. And this is why you got to repent right now, because there's so many people today who have strayed from God's word and want to do things their way because of offense and bitterness. But that's not no excuse. Submit yourself to God. Then you can resist the devil and he will flee from you. So you're wondering why sickness keeps running you down. You're wondering why it seems like you're unprotected or uncovered. It seems like all these bad things keep happening to you. It's like you're living under a curse. You're living under a curse because you're not living under authority. If you want to live under the hand of God, you got to submit yourself under his hand. You submit yourself to his word. You submit to what principles, what he teaches, what it instructs us, his precepts, his order. You can't do what you want to do in life and think God is going to bless you. God blesses the submitted. Those who choose to obey his word, he blesses them. It's so simple. So if the word of God says right is right, and I want to do what's left, I want to go the left way while the right way is what God says, then if you go in the left way, you are not under his divine protection. You are not under his divine covering. You're not under his divine provision. You're not under his divine mercy. Because you gotta do things God's way if you want God's results. I hope this is helping someone. Now, thing about authority is this. It's another thing you want to know about authority. God loves all people equally, but not all people are equal in authority. God loves all people equally, but not all people are equal in authority. I want you to write that down in the chat. I'm going to say it one more time, a little tongue twister. God loves all people equally, but not all people are equal in authority. In authority. Remember why I said authority is given. But I also want you to know authority is earned. Authority is earned. Authority is earned. It's earned. You cannot take authority. You cannot buy authority. It must be earned. Now, Pastor, that doesn't sound like the grace message because, you know, everything is just given to us for free. Let me show you something in the scriptures. You know the Bible says in Luke chapter 1, I believe it was in verse 52, or is it Luke 2, 52, one of those verses. The Bible says that Jesus increased in favor with God and man. Jesus increased. He grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with man. Everything is not given to you just because. Yes, you have access to it, but you earn certain levels of favor, certain levels of stature and wisdom with God and with people by how you live your life. See, the question is, God wants to entrust you with more authority, but can he trust you? God wants to entrust you with more authority, but can he trust you with that authority? I mean, let's make it practical once again. When your parents gave you a key to the house, you didn't get a key to go in and out of the house just because. You got a key when you proved that you were trustworthy, responsible enough to take care of that key, because that key meant you got more authority in the house. Ah. So before keys are given to you, parents have to make sure that you are of age or reach an age of maturity in which you can handle the responsibility of the key. What if the reason why God has not given you more authority was because you have not proven that you are worthy of for the responsibility? You see, authority is given, but authority must be earned. And you have to show and demonstrate, just like you got to listen to your parents at home. You got to follow their instructions. If they tell you to go come in at a certain time, you had to come in at a certain time. So they'll know, okay, this person is showing some maturity. They sound like they're ready to handle more responsibility. If they gave you chores, you had to show up and demonstrate that you can do it. All right, now let's shift it to the job. If you want that promotion, you want that managerial role, you want that position of supervisor, guess what? You have to demonstrate that you can be trusted with more authority. So when the supervisor that you're under asks you to do something and you get an attitude and you get angry and you don't want to be told what to do, you are not ready for supervisor role. Because you cannot submit to the person that is an authority over you at the moment. Are you following me? If you want promotion and at anything, at any level, guess what? You have to learn how to submit to God-given and God-appointed authority. And remember what I said, God loves all people equally, but not all people have equal authority. The government, for example, our president or our governor or our mayor has authority over the city or over the nation. And with that authority, they have the power to do things you don't have the power to do because they have the authority to do it. And Romans chapter 13, let's look at Romans 13. God wants you to see this in the word, that God honors authority and that authority must be honored and respected. That if you want to grow in your authority in the natural and in the spiritual, you've got to learn how to respect authority, whether you like them or not. I got to throw that in there because a lot of times, people will submit to people who they agree with. But what about when you have somebody who's an authority over you and you don't agree with them? If you can't submit to someone that you don't agree with, then you're not submitted. Whew. Why? Because submission, watch this, submission truly begins when you disagree. Submission truly begins when you disagree. You know, like when you were a child and your parent told you to do something and you didn't necessarily think that what they were telling you was the right thing. You wanted to stay out later and they said, no, I want you in at a certain time. And you got mad and you didn't want to do it. Or when your parent tells you, you got to go to school today. And you're like, I don't want to go to school. Well, you're going to school. Submission is when I want to do my own thing, the person whose authority I'm under has given me an instruction, I'm choosing to listen. Let's bring it into the home. Who has authority in the house? In a marriage, who's supposed to have authority? A husband, the man, has authority in the house. He has the authority to manage and to rule that house well. When a wife refuses to submit or listen to their husband's leadership or instructions, that's disorder and that becomes dysfunction. Okay? The husband or the man has authority over the house, period. That's why Eve was supposed to be submitted to Adam's rule and Adam's authority. Now, Adam didn't rule well. He didn't manage his wife well. And as a result of that, caused sin. But the thing is, today in our households, a husband is supposed to be the head of the house. That's what it means by head. It means the principal or leader. The one who decision-making has to be deferred to. Okay? Now, let's say the husband and the wife are in agreement. Guess what? The children, if they have kids in the house, the children ought to be submitted to their parents. Now, if parents are listening to their children and letting their children tell them what to do, then that's also wrong. That's dysfunction and that's chaos because the children are supposed to obey their parents according to Ephesians chapter 6. So this authority issue, it is everywhere. And when we don't understand authority, we don't understand how the kingdom works. And if we don't understand how the kingdom works, we can never see the blessing of God truly manifest in our homes, in our lives, in our workplace, in our nation. Because we won't be able to resist the devil and any one of his attacks if we are not submitted. Every area of your life where you are not submitted to God is open for attack from Satan. And there's nothing you can do about it because you are not covered under authority. When you are under authority, you are undercover. When you are under authority, you are undercover. Woo, hallelujah. Is this good? Romans 13, watch this. Romans chapter 13, verse 1. Let every soul be subject to the higher powers. Let every soul be subject to the higher powers. So here it is, there's an understanding. The word powers there is where we get exousia from, delegated authorities. So let every soul be subject to the delegated authorities or the powers that are higher than you. He's not talking about God here, the higher power. No, higher powers, he's speaking of people who are in positions and are in ranks and have titles that are in a role that is above you. For there is no power but of God. The powers that are ordained, the powers that be are ordained or ordered of God. So the Bible says that every soul must learn to submit themselves to higher powers. When you go to school as a student, your professor, your dean, your principal, that's your higher power. When you're at work, your manager, your supervisor, that's your higher power. That's the person you got to give an answer to. The person who's writing you a check, that's you're submitted to them. When you're in church, your pastors, your ministers, they are higher powers. All God loves everyone equally, but not all people have equal authority. When you're in homerooms and small groups, your small group leader is your higher power. And I say, well, Pastor, we've been saved a long time. Yeah, but they have been delegated or given authority. You see, remember, authority is given. So when you join a church and a pastor has ordained someone to lead, someone to teach, you submitting to them and listening to them is just as if you're submitting to God and you're submitting to your pastor. Why? Because they were delegated or appointed. Authority comes from God. Authority must be delegated. You cannot take authority or give yourself authority. The minute you attempt to do that, you are operating in a spirit of rebellion. Hallelujah. And how do you think you think you're working for God? If you are rebellious, the devil is a liar. Rebellious spirits and rebellious attitudes will never, ever last. That's what happened with Absalom, David's son. I can't get into that, but David had a son named Absalom who rebelled against his father. And the Bible shows us that he was very liked. He was talented. He was just like his dad, handsome like his dad, gifted like his dad. But he never got to the throne because of a rebellious spirit that he developed. Man, I'm telling you, the spirit of rebellion, get this out of your soul right now and humble yourself. Submit yourself to the hand of God. Submit yourself to the word of God. This is what's going to keep you in these last days. Because the Bible says in the last days, the spirit of lawlessness and rebellion is going to sweep through the earth. And God forbid this sweeps through hungry for God. We are going to be a people of humility. We're going to be a people who understand order. We are going to be a people that understand the importance of God-given authority. because he gives his grace to the humble, and the humble are those who understand authority. All right? So the Bible says, whoever resists, verse 2, you see that word resist? Whoever therefore resists the power or resists the ordinance, the establishment of order of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. Guys, this warning can't get any more severe than that. If you don't learn to submit to God-given authorities, the Bible says you are going to receive to yourself damnation, judgment. This is Romans 13, verse 2. Rebellion is no small thing. Damnation, when you're receiving damnation, you're receiving eternal punishment as a consequence of sin. It's no small thing. Look at verse 3. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Will you then not be afraid of the power? Do what is good, and you shall have praise of the same. All right? So God-given appointed rulers. Rulers here speaking about those in authority. Those who are in authority are not a terror to good works, but they are only a terror to the evil. People who are in positions of authority are not supposed to scare the people who are doing good things, because if you're doing good work, guess what? People in authority want to celebrate you. People in authority are looking for people who are performing well, who are living an excellent life, who are making their workplace better, who are improving the culture of their church by truly honoring and truly submitting and following the instructions of the leadership. You're a blessing. When you obey leadership, you are the biggest blessing in town. You don't have to worry about the cops when the cops stop you if you are operating from a spirit of honor and respect to authority. We're not going to talk about this, but a lot of the people who get in big trouble with the police get into big trouble because they carry the aura of arrogance and rebellion against authority, police. The spirit of rebellion, that Black Lives Matter contributed to the Black community, I don't endorse it. We ought to respect authority. We ought to respect police officers, law enforcers. Respect them. Not because they all are good, but because they have the position and the authority that they have. And what I've found is when you are respectful, honoring of them, and you see from God's point of view, listen, I got to respect you because of who you are. I got to respect you because of the position, the title you have. You can't say you're just a man like me. You just got that badge. You just got that gun. If you didn't have that badge and that gun, let me see what you would do to me. You see, that type of thinking, to believe that because they are just like you and they are protected by their position or their authority, actually lets me know that you don't honor the position. Guys, this is why you gotta learn. I gotta wrap this up soon. You gotta learn how to honor and respect titles and positions, even if you don't agree who's in the seat of authority. You don't have to, I'm gonna say it again, you don't have to agree with the person who's in authority. But if they're in a position of authority, understand this. Romans 13, what did the word of God say? Let every soul be subject to the higher powers. For there's no power but of God. And the powers that are ordained of God. So I'm going to respect your position and your authority and I'm going to do what you say because you're in a position of authority or you're in a higher power over me. Humble yourself. Guys, a lot of your problems, 80% of your problems, will disappear if you learn how to submit. You don't got to prove that you're right. You don't have to prove that you're right. Some of you had mentors, and you burned the relationship with your mentors because you tried to prove that you were right to your mentor. The mentor, the mentee is never supposed to correct the mentor. If somebody is mentoring you and they're teaching you something and you feel like what they're telling you is wrong, shut up about it. Don't say anything. Let them share. Let them tell you what they're telling you. Because they didn't ask for your input. They didn't ask for your advice. As a matter of fact, you came to them because you saw that they had something on their life that you needed to see in your life. So whatever they tell you to do, shut up and do it. That's how you extract the blessing of being properly aligned to someone who can develop you and bring you into new levels of influence and power and ability because you submit to them. I'm going to even tell you this. The child should never correct the parent. The children do not have the right to correct their parents. Unless the parent asks for input. But you don't just get up and correct your parents. That's not how you do it, Mom. That's not how you do it, Dad. You'll never be blessed that way. Unless your parents ask, or unless there is a conversation where it says, hey, I'm welcoming your input. Because the minute you begin to do that, you disassociate yourself from the honor that is supposed to be rightfully displayed. Upwards, children, obey your parents in the Lord. Honor your parents. Honor your father and mother. The Bible never says that the parents are supposed to honor the children. Whew. Oh my God. The Bible never says the child is supposed to honor the parents. The Bible says honor your leaders. The Bible never says that the leaders are supposed to honor their followers. Why? Does that mean that they shouldn't be honored back and forth? It should be. But here's where it starts. The person who is in the seat of authority is already in a seat of honor. Honor the position. Honor the seat. Honor the role. Honor your mom and dad because they are your mom and dad, period. Not because they are perfect. Honor your leaders. Honor your pastors. Honor your supervisors. Honor your president. Not because they are perfect, but because of the seat and the position they're in. You don't even understand how much stress and pressure is in that seat. And some of you say, well, if I had that role, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll be better than them. And guess what? You get that role, you won't even last a few weeks. Because that spirit of rebellion is going to come back and bite you. So I'm going to end right there. We're going to pray. We're going to ask the Lord to correct us as we submit ourselves to his word. If you know there's any areas in your life where you've been struggling, any area in your life that seems like it's been unfruitful and unproductive, it's most likely you've been carrying a spirit of rebellion in some way, shape, or form, and it's been producing damnation. Can't work. It's condemned. It's like in the spirit realm, it's almost like I'm seeing abandoned houses that are condemned. No one buys it. No one lives in it. It's just a condemned property. No life there, no fruitfulness there. It's barren, it's a wasteland because it's condemned. And I just see the angels in the spirit now getting ready to take off some of those places that have been hard to grow and hard to develop in your life because it's been damned by spirits of rebellion and disobedience. And we're going to pray and ask the Lord to break any curse that might have been on our lives through rebellion and disobedience. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry. I didn't understand how important authority was up until this moment. Teach me to honor all who are in authority. Forgive me for every negative word, attitude that I've ever released or spoken over anyone in authority over me. I pray, Lord, that you will heal my heart. Help me to take on a spirit of humility today, that I may humble myself to those that have rule over me, so that I can see your blessing, your full blessing, come into my life. Forgive me of my sin of disobedience and rebellion, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Break any curse over my life, over my children, over my family. Take it away, Lord, and I'm ready to change. I repent. And thank you for your mercy, for being a merciful God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. So, guys, if this message has blessed you today, I want to challenge you to be a blessing. I want to challenge you to be a blessing. I would love for you to partner with us by sowing a seed tonight into this teaching. All right, I want to challenge you to sow into tonight's teaching. Wow, I feel the anointing. I feel something powerful is in this room, and something broke off of some of your life. Just as simple as that. Making this one change to begin to establish honor to those in authority above you. I want you to sow a seed tonight. If you can, find a way to sow tonight. I want you to be a blessing into this word. We want you to follow the giving prompts or inside of our descriptions. You can see there's multiple ways to give. You can give via Cash App at $H4G Global, or you can give via text. Text the word H4G give to 77977. That is 77977. Text H4G give, and you will receive a link to your phone. Or if you want to give via Zelle, you can give h4gnation@gmail.com. Or if you want to give on PayPal, you can also give h4gnation@gmail.com. But if this word blessed you, you feel enriched, you feel empowered, you feel equipped, sow a seed tonight. Get as close as you can to the seed of 25. If you can find a seed of 25 and sow it into the anointing, I want to pray over that and bless you tonight, that God will begin to release the dams off of your life, and you will begin to experience a surge or a flood of God's blessings coming back into your life. So we honor you tonight, guys. Thank you so much. H4G, I love you. I'll see you guys next week. Share this broadcast with someone that needs to know about the grace of God. And until then, you can join us on Sunday in person for our Sunday experience. Make sure you push the subscribe button so that you don't miss a single message that's coming down the pipeline here at H4G. I love you. See you guys next week. Walk in love, walk in grace, walk in humility. God bless you.